Good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, depending on where you're calling in from. My name is Lisa Chandonnet Bedoya. I am a senior conflict and peacebuilding advisor. I am with USAID's Center for Conflict and Violence Prevention in the Bureau for Conflict Prevention and Stabilization. I'm very excited to be your facilitator here this afternoon. I have been with USAID for what will be 20 years next month. And while I lead our Latin America and Caribbean team, I would be remiss without indicating that I've spent a number of years covering West Africa as well as East Africa. So just very excited to be here this afternoon and have an opportunity with my esteemed panelists to be able to focus on just such sort of diverse professional as well as geographic diversity here. So for those of you who are just joining, the panel session has been is titled Insights from Conflict Sensitivity Hubs in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in Honduras, in South Sudan, and Sudan. So this session aims to highlight examples of where conflict sensitivity integration support, in particular capacity building and technical assistance, has really led to concrete changes in the practice or the way that we do our development, while simultaneously addressing the drivers of conflict and violence. Part of conflict sensitivity integration, I'm sure many of you are familiar with, is not only understanding the conflict context and the interaction effect, but really acting, making those sort of practical changes on the ground in response to what we're seeing. So before we begin, I'd like to flag just a few logistics for those of you who have just joined in terms of this virtual platform. So what you'll see is if you look down to the right, it should be on the right of your screen, there is a button called More. If you click on More, you'll notice that there is a translation or an interpretation button. What we ask is that we have interpretation simultaneous in both Spanish and French. So please do check that little globe so you have an opportunity to hear from our speakers in whichever language makes sense for you or that you prefer. We also have Alliance for Peacebuilding staff that are here should you come or run into any technical difficulties. We also have the chat function open, as well as obviously the hand-raising function. We also recognize that there might be some issues with bandwidth. So if you do run into it and want to keep your cameras off, completely understand. At the same token, while there are great opportunities to engage in a virtual platform with people from all over the world, we also sometimes miss some of those nonverbal cues. So if you are speaking, it would be great if you could actually turn your camera on so we can see one another, because that's one of the challenges when we're not together. So we have designed this session to focus on cross-regional learning and to include opportunities not only to hear from my esteemed panelists, but also really from you, from the participants in the room who have, I'm sure, a vast array of experiences and expertise. And what we'll do is have an opportunity to hear from the panelists, but then pose questions to you to really help enhance some of the learning on conflict sensitivity integration. So what I'd like to do now is just turn to each of our panelists. If we could start, please, with Ms. Orfelia Perez first, just to do about a 1-minute introduction, sort of who you are, your expertise, and then we'll move forward with, I'm hoping Abdurrahman Saleh is on the line, and if not, we can go to Mr. Robert Morris next. But Orfelia, over to you.
Thank you, Lisa. Good afternoon. My name is Orfelia Perez. I am the leader of the team of conflict analysis and training for the Conflict Sensitivity Integration Hub in Honduras. My role has been to be this contact point between the technical staff members and the implementers of USAID in Honduras in order to facilitate and accompany technical assistance, research efforts, and training in conflict sensitivity. It is an honor to share this space with all of you today. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you, Orfelia. Robert?
Thanks, Lisa, and good afternoon. Good evening, everyone. My name is Rob. I'm the Global Team Lead for Safer World's portfolio of conflict sensitivity facilities. You'll hear me talk about facilities rather than hubs. I think these terms are pretty much interchangeable, but very curious to hear any nuances that come out of today's discussion. So the lessons that I'll talk about today primarily will draw on two facilities that we run. Firstly, the Conflict Sensitivity Resource Facility, CSRF in South Sudan, I've been involved in the CSRF since 2018, and I've held multiple roles there as an advisor, interim director, and now I'm in a role overseeing the facilities overall, A Safer World, based in London, but mostly in East Africa. I'm also working very much on the conflict sensitivity facility, similarly and confusingly named CSF, which has been operational in Sudan since 2021. So we really see these as kind of sister projects that very much complement each other. Thanks for inviting me to take part, and very much looking forward to hearing from and learning from you.
So let me at least, if he's able to join us, provide a little bit of background for him. So Mr. Saleh, he has a doctorate in international relations and 10 years of experience coordinating regional programs, served as a conflict analysis trainer, has worked in the Sahel, the Great Lakes region, and currently working with International Alert as the director of the DRC Conflict Sensitivity Hub based in Kinshasa. Previously, he's worked with NDI, Search for Common Ground, as well as several local NGOs in Niger. So very brief background. We're hoping that whatever technical difficulties have occurred with Zoom, that he will be able to join us shortly, just because we know he has a wealth of knowledge and also just sort of rounding out that geographical diversity, which is so key. Okay, so thank you again for joining us this afternoon, and just really excited to dig into how conflict sensitivity integration hub or resource facility models work, and quite honestly, how they align to one of the key themes of PeaceCon, which focuses on integrating and aligning peace building and conflict prevention. And this is precisely what conflict sensitivity integration seeks to do. It seeks to move us beyond our sectoral siloed approaches and ensure that the contexts that we are operating in are not only analyzed, but that we adapt. We adapt our program based on the context. And I think for me, one of my personal goals is to make sure that we see the understanding of the interaction effect, the effect of the environment on our activities and our activities on the environment, just second nature, so that it becomes like the way that we actually do development, always thinking about it. Because this will allow us to seize opportunities, really, to seize opportunities to not only reduce drivers of conflict and violence, but building towards that peace, finding connections or connectors, as we use that that term within the field of conflict sensitivity integration, and get to positive peace, which is something I think that we really all seek to support within the countries and societies and communities that we're working in. So for those who have just joined the session, what we will focus on is really demonstrating how conflict sensitivity integration hub models are a program approach. They can be adapted, they can be replicated and scaled. You will hear this afternoon examples, tangible examples, as well as best practices of how hub models have contributed to increased program effectiveness, improved development, but also conflict prevention outcomes. With different models, quite honestly. Some are single donor funded, others are sort of basket or multi-donor funded, as well as sort of the fact that these organizational models are tested at different levels, but they're all designed to be nimble, to be responsive to the communities, to enhance localization, and really, quite honestly, build the trust, I think, that we know is needed in working in conflict and violence prevention. So the final point I'll make, just again, logistically, if you haven't had a chance or if you've just joined and you need any interpretation, if you click that more button, you will see a globe. You can choose French or Spanish, obviously, or English, as you prefer. So what I'd like to do now is really just turn to my esteemed panelists and hear from them. We'll spend about 30 minutes or 10 minutes each hearing about these different models. How are they organized? How are they structured? What are some of the best practices and what are some of the challenges? And as I mentioned, each one is a little bit different. So we really want to give you the time and the space to dig into some of this. So let me turn first to our panelist, Orfelia Perez, please, to take us through the CSIH model in Honduras. Orfelia, over to you.
Thank you, Lisa. The CSI, the Conflict Sensitive Integration Hub, is a three-year pilot project financed by USAID. The purpose is to integrate learning about conflict and violence and putting it down in Honduras, raising awareness and sensitivity on conflict. The center articulates around three objectives that are interrelated with one another. The first goal, analysis and research. Here is where we have developed analysis of spaces of conflict that are specifically adapted to activities, to programs, or to a location. The peace and conflictivity analysis analyzes the dynamic of conflicts, but also it focuses on peace opportunities. It provides entry points, clear entry points, so that programs can inform on their design or on how their schedule is adapted. The second purpose that we are after at our site is technical assistance, personalized technical assistance. This is where we develop and we analyze tools for integrating awareness around conflicts. We develop and we adapt information around conflicts, and we accompany programs for their implementation and adaptation of the sensitivity to the conflict sensitivity integration approach. The third goal, monitoring, assessment, and learning. This is where we recover evidence on conflict sensitivity. This is where we adapt, and this is where we learn as a project, and this is where we learn the best practices with a wider audience. The conflict sensitivity integration hub in Honduras is working on a demand basis. This means that a person or staff members from your site in Honduras makes a request. The hub responds according to the specifications of that request. And the hub will support and has been supporting the USAID portfolio in Honduras. And integration around conflict sensitivity has been approached based on a number of different theme areas, namely health, access to justice, governance, citizen security, environment, social infrastructure, among others. One of our good practices has included developing analysis around peace and conflictivity, tailor-made to the needs of each conflict, of each project. With these efforts, we were able to show the use of our approach to conflicts. We have helped programs understand about the dynamics around conflicts, and we provide specific entry points for quick adaptability and programming or scheduling. In this case, I will refer to three examples as to how the hub turned challenges into best practices and best practices into success cases around conflict sensitivity. These are a token and a sample of the dynamic in Honduras that from the hub we have carried out. The first example is about a governance program initially. So the program was among those that took long to adopt conflict sensitivity, yet its success highlights not just best practices in response to these operational challenges, but also in connection to a number of external complex challenges. One of the biggest challenges the hub faced, because it was one that was highly sensitive from a political point of view. This governance program has a long-standing record in the country, and it is very legitimate. According to one of the districts, a newly elected mayor had to face strong opposition, and that brought about difficulties around consensus and in making progress with the program. There was a high level of conflict at the time, and there was a seemingly lack of flexibility in approaching high priority issues. the program requested the support from the hub. We carried out a peace and conflictivity analysis, a brief and quick one, in trying to gain an understanding of the root causes of conflicts and also the situations or the points that could be a common thread to which all the stakeholders involved would share. The capacity the hub had in adapting that support to the needs of their program in order to help them achieve those goals entrusted by the donor was essential in them gaining an understanding of the relevance on the conflict sensitivity approach. I will now share a second example. It has to do with a violence prevention program. This violence prevention program showed from the very beginning due diligence, how diligent it was in adapting the conflict sensitivity approach across the board. And it also was very successful. This is not just because of good practices that were implemented in responding to those challenges, but also because of those complex external factors that meant high risk vis-a-vis the strategy to reduce violence and preventing violence around the way gangs operate. I mean, gangs, modus operandums. This program has been longstanding in Honduras and it has been very legitimate. We strengthened the structure of the police authority and we started working on tertiary prevention. That, of course, meant challenges on how to generate trust and on how to strengthen the local capacities. With this program, we developed a peace and conflictivity program that helped them significantly improve on their planning. It also helped them make decisions and it helped them design strategies to exchange knowledge. Some participants have not muted their microphone and they interrupt. With the peace and conflictivity analysis, they managed to incorporate in a far better manner what gender sensitivity is all about. This program has plans to expand the age range. This keeps interrupting and therefore it makes understanding difficult. They have identified in a better way what risks are that they face with the gangs that are present at schools. A third program and that is also a token of good practices is one on peace promotion. This program on peace promotion tries to strengthen the role of women and youth from native communities to work and live in safe and protected environments. This program, right from the onset, from the beginning, showed a strong approach on conflict sensitivity, such as the other programs. Its success also underscored how relevant the best practices are in order to meet the operating challenges and also to provide response to those external complex structural challenges that are around these Aboriginal communities in Honduras that have been for long marginalized and set aside. This has been their fate for much too long. With them, we carried out a peace and conflictivity analysis that shed light in their understanding of the dynamic of conflicts and violence, where these communities, these native communities, the Maya and Chorsti and Lenca are involved with in Honduras. The peace and conflictivity analysis was also the basis to help design their effective strategies, those that would be culturally sensitive in promoting peace and in reducing violence by the participation of young people and women of their local communities. Recommendations were very quickly adapted by the program, and they highlighted on how important localized interventions would be with the basis on the community, with culturally sensitive approaches, such as how to strengthen the language, the indigenous language, teaching indigenous languages at schools. The result of these peace and conflictivity analysis in this project shows that they were able to improve the integration of conflict sensitivity and conflict reactions in their design and in their planning. They managed to have better strategic partnerships and greater trust aligned with that culture, with the indigenous culture, in a very, very down-to-earth manner. These are the three experiences of good practices that we've had in Honduras. For your information, Lisa and colleagues, thank you.
Thank you so very much, Orfelia, for providing those three examples within the Conflict Sensitivity Integration Hub in Honduras. I see that Monsieur Abdurrahman Saleh has joined us, I believe, from the Democratic Republic of the Congo. If it works and you're ready, I would love to turn it over to you to just do a brief introduction, but then also to spend the next 10 minutes just talking about the hub, your engagement with it, how it's set up in DRC, some of the successes, and then the challenges of operating in the context that you're in. Over to you.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'm sorry for some issues linked to the internet connection. Regarding conflict sensitivity in the DRC, the hub was created in 2021 after the consultation with the different development actors, then different ONG. We created our hub with FDDE help. And so we started our activity in 2021. And starting from 2022, our pilot phase stopped, and we started our work with the main phase, which started in 2022, and which continued till 2026. The main objective is to help the humanitarian and development and peace building actors, to help them in their integration, in the appropriation, and in the use of lesson learned. And that is why our hub in the DRC is very important. This is a hub which is directed towards the outside, towards all the actors of development and peace. And with their help, we use the contextual analysis to have the update of the context in order to be able to adapt our activity and to respond to the needs of the community, which need our help. The other thing, we have consolidated our capacity thanks to the work on this conflict sensibility, and we worked on this to really understand the context of the situation and improve the best outcomes and to reduce the negative outcome. And that is why that is how we are making our skills transfer. So we if the organization asked us, we offer them the training. We give them the technical capacity so that they can integrate the conflict awareness to their approaches. And so we are working from 2024. We have worked with 10 different actors, and we have helped 243 local organizations starting from the start of our pilot projects in 2021. And we also help 63 international organizations who are working in DRC, and 10 United Nations agencies have integrated this approach of conflict sensibility thanks to the adapted research to their cases. For example, we helped an international organization who works in DRC on cash. We helped them to develop the orientation to take into consideration the conflict sensibility in the deliverance of the cash delivery and the cash transfer in fragile contexts. And thanks to our help, the organization could integrate in 2023 all the different conflict sensibility components. They could propose trainings, and they could implement the conflict analysis at the institutional level. Now, another example, we are now working with Newt on the Nexus Task Force, which is now working. We have started to manage this task force to train them on the notions, first of all, on conflict sensitivity, first of all. And in this project, we explained them all the conflict dynamics so that it is be reflected at the local level, so they could better adapt it, so they can take into account the dynamic. And so in not to worsen the situation in certain cases, so they're better prepared. We have also worked with the coordination platform. For example, we worked with a cash working group, which is still linked to us. I want to explain that we are working in a fragile conflict situation like in DRC, where it's still quite difficult to transfer the cash. That is why we have worked with this task force in conditions of a sensitive conflict situation. We are not only working in at the program level, we are also working at the strategic level, and we take into the consideration the context of the situation, and we systemize this this data in the platform. So we regroup in our cash transferring platform 32 different organizations. And I can tell you that when they did their interaction analysis after a certain number of operations, they have seen a great improvement, not only in the stages of the help they were offering, but also they've seen the improvement of the well-being of the communities. So the risk is that when you inject cash in the conditions of armed groups' existence, you can have different difficulties, even linked to different assaults. So you have to take into consideration all these difficulties, and you have to understand who are the beneficiaries of this cash transfers. And so we have to take into consideration the different situation of these beneficiary communities. And so I understood that your question was also what were the challenges, the main challenge and the particularity of this hub and of all the actors is that it is not a hub which is working alone. We have our impact through the impact of our help, of our aid. It's a little bit difficult to say what are those exact challenges because those actors have been working for 30 years in the conflict settings. But the problem is the updates. That is the main challenge for those actors. They know the global context because they have the information from the authorities. But when we intervene in a specific sectorial area, we have to understand the global context. But at the same time, we have to understand the risks and the opportunities linked to the actions we're going to undertake. And that is the challenge, to understand this particularity. That is the main difficulty. And of course, there are some goodwill that have been explained by those participating organizations to learn more on this. And they are really very open towards taking into consideration these conflict sensibility issues. The second issue is the financial resources. We are working with ONG with NGOs, and in their majority, they don't have their proper funding. And if you don't have the funding, this project cannot function. So we have the engagement, we have our tools, but we don't have funding sometimes. So we are working with Canada, with Germany. We're working on our projects with Holland, with the G7, and we have the funds which we use. So we use those money to fill in the gaps for difficult projects, trying to take into consideration different activities. We take into consideration not only the result of the project, but also the visibility and the pertinence of the importance of the intervention in a certain context. That is what I wanted to share. I hope that I had your question.
Yes, thank you so very much. Thank you for that really expansive sort of, you can understand how many organizations, in particular your hub has been able to really touch and impact. So thank you so very much for explaining that. I'd love hearing the different nuances, even just only with two so far. So with that, I'd love to turn it over to Robert Morris. So he's has a chance as well to speak to us about the two different hubs covering one with South Sudan and one with Sudan. And so we can hear even more about sort of how these are different or similar. Apologies. Do you mind muting if you are not speaking? Could you kindly mute yourself? I don't have the ability to just mute people. Gerard, can you mute yourself, please? Thank you. Over to you, Robert.
Thank you so much, Nisa. Fascinating hearing those experiences from the other hubs. So I'm going to share examples from the two projects I mentioned before that Safe World is involved in. And it is a real privilege to be able to represent the teams putting in that hard work on the ground to run these projects today. The experience from Abdulrahman and Wafili made it sound so easy, right? But yeah, speaking, when you focus on success, it is easy to forget the challenges. So I hope I do justice to both sides today. So a brief overview of the two projects that I'll draw on. The CSRF in South Sudan is operated in a consortium comprising Safer World and Swiss Peace. We established the facility in 2016, and it's just entering its third phase of implementation, having gone through a pilot and then an expanded phase since then, and currently have funding from the UK, Netherlands, Switzerland, Canada, and the EU. We've got about 10 people in South Sudan, 8 of whom are South Sudanese, based in Juba, with some support provided remotely as well. And then the second project is the CSF in Sudan. That was founded more recently in 2021 with funding from the US, the UK, EU, and Switzerland. It's a little bit smaller, comprising a core team of 5 staff that are spread out across the region as a result of the displacement from Sudan that we've seen. So these are particularly different contexts from Honduras, as you'll understand, and to some extent from DRC. So perhaps some of what I will talk about reflects the different nature of the context and the kind of challenges that come up in and opportunities that arise in providing support in a context of this sort. The examples that I'll share will hopefully complement those shared by Orfilia and Abdulrahman. One of the things that makes the CSRF and the CSF a bit different to many other forms of conflict sensitivity support is that while we do provide that bilateral capacity support to donor programs, one of the key design assumptions underpinning the CSF and the CSRF is that these facilities really provide a public good to the wider aid sector. So we're not only providing that kind of responsive support to implementing partners from donors that we're funded by, but really looking to support the whole sector there, balancing, you know, some demand-driven work where we do respond to requests, but also recognizing where we think there needs to be more work done as an aid community in these contexts. And we really use 3 approaches that are quite similar to those that Orfilia described and the CSI Hub in Honduras. The first is around capacity strengthening. So we have a work stream that focuses on trainings, mentoring, accompaniment. The second is a work stream focused on knowledge generation and management. So that includes both doing our own research and analysis, but also hosting online platforms to improve others' access to a wider body of information, not just our own, but the other research, evaluations, publications put out by other organizations. And then the third work stream, which we think is really important, is around outreach and learning. So this is really focused on building relationships, convening people from different parts of the community, Sudanese or South Sudanese, and international NGO, UN donors, around shared problems, holding roundtables where we can surface expertise in different ways and connect people to have conversations and share learning. So those are the 3 work streams that we use. And the public good element of these facilities really constitutes, I would say, the majority of our work and enables us to work a bit more strategically to strengthen awareness and pursue entry points where we see them arising. So the first lesson, and I'll try to keep this relatively short, and I'm afraid won't have so much time to go deep into the examples, but I mean, on the challenges front, Lisa, you started out by mentioning that word trust. And I want to come back to that because we know that working in conflict effective contexts is really difficult. And when you're raising issues around conflict sensitivity and seeking to support about them, people can get a bit prickly. People can get nervous, especially if you're coming in as an outsider saying, I can help you do this. And people need to be vulnerable with you to have that meaningful form of support and share what they're really finding difficult if this is to go beyond just a tick box process. And so the first lesson I really just wanted to emphasize is that the successful provision of conflict sensitivity support really benefits from a strong, sustained relationship that enables that support to be delivered in the right way at the right time, rather than a one size fits all approach that can be forced on projects or organizations from the outside. And it was really great to hear Orfilia talk about tailoring support. And that is so important. We share that experience. Tailoring support to the organization is critical. And often the best examples that we've come across of conflict sensitivity practice arising from our support actually emerge very slowly and incrementally over time, where we've invested that time in building a relationship, maybe sometimes speculatively, not knowing necessarily where it's going to lead, always strategically, recognizing that, you know, someone has particular influence, the size of someone's programming, someone's influence locally and with key stakeholders, or some rationale for why you want to work with someone, but not necessarily going in with a key objective in terms of this is the problem we want to solve here. And so this slow burn, sustained form of support is quite different to some other forms that focus on the short-term external expertise being brought in around an inception or design process. It's much more exploratory. And we found that connecting our outreach work and the capacity strengthening work in this way has helped us to build a credibility and trust that helps partners to open up and approach us with problems when they come up for them, so that we're able, they know that we're there to provide support when they have that challenge or have that problem. And as a result, the nature of the support that we provide, the kind of problems that we work on, are often quite unpredictable in advance, right? And we need to have that flexibility to respond to the rhythm of partners' availability and priorities. That's so important in humanitarian contexts, as most of us will have worked in, because people are just so busy, right? And getting on people's radar often means starting support. Sometimes you'll start support, something will happen, nothing moves. Then you need to be able to put it on ice, come back to it a little while later when someone's got a little bit more time. And respecting that rhythm is an important part of that trust building process, and being there to help when people do have questions is key. So one of the examples that might help to illustrate how this works concretely is from Sudan, where the CSF team had been building a relationship with the protection cluster and OCHA to share information and talk about conflict sensitivity for some time. But that was only with some focal points. And then at one point, maybe over a year into that process, the humanitarian country team in Sudan requested that OCHA incorporate conflict sensitivity into the Sudan Humanitarian Fund. So OCHA delegates this to the protection cluster. Then they approach the CSF as an independent advisor, having that relationship, who can they collaborate with, brainstorm, think about how to integrate conflict sensitivity into those existing fund processes, the SHF fund processes. So following that brainstorming session, we worked with the cluster to carry out a briefing to members and then incorporated questions relating to conflict sensitivity into the SHF's project proposal processes and templates that applicants would have to complete in order to seek funding. We also accompanied this by a training to all SHF applicants, optional, to help them understand the new expectations and equip them with the skills to conduct their own mini conflict sensitivity analysis as part of that proposal development process. And a large number of applicants, what was great to see, actually ended up reflecting this in their applications, albeit with varying levels of quality. This stuff isn't easy, but in some cases we saw some really concrete traction. We saw WASH cluster proposals, including social cohesion components to mitigate competition over water in particular hotspot areas. Another proposal adapting its post-distribution monitoring to include indicators around conflict sensitivity risks as well. And since then, we've also been invited to review these applications, provide independent comment, and include recommendations of how applicants can further strengthen their approach. So it just goes to show that we wouldn't have been able to predict any of this in advance. What we really need is that standing capacity and that trust that you can then work organically with and creatively with people who have particular problems or where opportunities arise, which I want to emphasize here. The fact that we had built that trust, we were pre-funded as well, was really important by donors, and were flexible enough with our work plan to respond has been critical. So the other lesson I want to touch on, and then I'll start to wrap up, is that we really need to go beyond looking at conflict sensitivity as a programming approach. I recognize some of the framing of this session emphasizes it as a programming lens. But I think there are two ways in which it's important to go beyond that. The first is that conflict sensitivity needs to be more strongly integrated at the system level rather than just the program level. When I talk about system, I talk about the aid system. And that can really help with the effectiveness and sustainability of support. I already spoke a bit about the Sudan Humanitarian Fund as one example where we're working at the interagency level with their systems and processes. But beyond that, we also know that conflict insensitivity often arises from a failure to coordinate and collaborate between agencies. And conflict sensitivity of the system as a whole, therefore, depends on the relationships to be able to better understand the context. to know when to come together when we have shared problems and to organize more collective coordinated responses. That might sound a bit abstract. So let me again provide an example to put flesh on those bones. So in South Sudan, we know that requests from authorities to aid agencies to support the resettlement of IDPs have frequently been divisive. In one case, you know, while one UN agency had accepted a request to support the resettlement of IDPs, most others had rejected it due to concerns that some of that support was facilitating changes in the ethnic composition of areas that would drive conflict in the longer term. So a failure of information sharing was leading one agency to be pressured by government and take a potentially conflict insensitive position, rather than agencies holding firm and having a shared stance. So following this, recognizing there was a challenge, the CSRF was brought in as a non-operational partner. You know, we don't have our own programming, into the Durable Solutions Working Group to help broker some difficult conversations between partners and work to integrate conflict sensitivity questions and considerations more explicitly into the due diligence processes and forms that they already have. And really helping them to be more intentional about looking at those risks. And in this way, working between agencies, we've helped to shape norms and processes that create incentives for more serious consideration of conflict sensitivity as part of returns planning. We've had a similar experience in Sudan where we've been working with the Access Working Group to agree and disseminate joint operating principles for the negotiation of access with authorities. And these kinds of coordination dilemmas and responses highlight how important it is to embed conflict sensitivity into the aid system as a whole, rather than just looking at it as a programming approach. Programming is necessary, but it's not the whole picture. The final point I'll make, then I'll stop, is just the other way in which we need to go beyond programming, I think, is looking at the operational footprint of aid. It was really good to hear Abdulrahman talk about the institutional level, and we really reinforce that as well as the CSRF and CSF, where we need to look at, you know, the root of many conflict sensitivity risks and dilemmas are often relating to our own human resources, our own finances, our own procurement, and so on. You know, in some cases, these are because the operational systems may be driving conflict. Perhaps the identity of our staff in some cases influences how we see the world, particularly around gender, I would say, and also around certain communities having more access to aid sector jobs. But in others, you know, maybe these systems are holding back adaptation, that move from the analysis to practice. And so if we had more time, I would go on to talk about some of the examples from our mentoring program in South Sudan, where we've been able to work with national NGOs to help them identify some of those challenges, adapt recruitment practices to have a more diverse staff body, working on issues of organizational culture, around hierarchical management that was preventing some feedback coming up from the field level to inform management level discussions. So these are really sensitive issues to work on, but again, come back to that issue of trust, which I really want to emphasize here, and having that long-term presence as a facility is one of the benefits of that we bring to a context like this. I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Thank you so very much. Just hearing, you know, now, four technically models, one of the things, not just the trust, but the time it takes to build that trust. And whether that trust be within communities, accompaniment with local organizations, mentoring programs, as you've just mentioned, Robert, or, you know, Orphelia, you had mentioned as well with the Conflict Sensitivity Integration Hub in Honduras. I mean, you're working accompanying different organizations. And I know, as someone who's worked closely with the hub in Honduras as well, that we all come with our own sort of histories and baggages with the organizations we're from. So whatever organization we are or are acting sort of in the name of, we are bringing that to these relationships. And so I think one of the things that is so interesting is that every one of these programs you've spoken to a little bit has said you began as a pilot, you tested, you adapted, you built the trust. You were not necessarily sure exactly where you may have been going with conflict sensitivity. There may have been starts, there may have been sort of fits, you may have had to reorient, but that's part of it, right? That is the heart of it, is being able to adapt. And so thank you for all of you for bringing the experiences that you have to not only the organization of these hubs, which are very different, as well as the context, but some of the approaches that have worked and some of the challenges you've seen. So we'd like to spend a few minutes and really open this up to our audience. I know that there are many people who have different experiences and expertise within conflict sensitivity and conflict sensitivity integration. So we'd be interested in at least having a little bit of an exchange learning to hear from you if there are certain approaches that you've seen work, adaptations that have really resonated. How you've seen that sort of link, as we mentioned, from the analysis, understanding the context, the interaction effects, to some of those adaptations. You know, we heard from Mr. Saleh in terms of DRC about sort of the, we know resource transfers can be some of the most pernicious challenges in terms of making sure that we understand conflict sensitivity integration and who benefits through our, you know, we have SAVE models, we have RAF models, all within, you know, understanding dividers and connectors. But I'd be interested in hearing from any participants here. Feel free to either raise your hand or drop something in the chat. What have you seen in particular, the type of approaches to conflict sensitivity in your context that have worked? And feel free to give us some background in terms of the context from those experiences. And then kind of the second point is, like, what can we do to support the sustainability of these outcomes? And how do we make sure that we are building local ownership through, whether it's, you know, mentoring, accompaniment? What do you, have you seen work for local context? It looks like, I believe it's Frederick Shalom who's raised his hand. Let me turn it over to you.
Well, that practice, without any doubt, it would mean to develop peace and conflictivity. This analysis analyze conflicts, and they are adapted to an activity or to a special location. But additionally to analyzing conflicts, they also identify peace opportunities, and these are the big challenges. There will always be opportunities down the horizon, for peace. And with the facilitation of specific points of entry that can be quickly adapted to how projects will be implemented and programmed. So that practice, those peace and conflictivity analysis would apply. The methodology leads to the development of a number of methodological steps that are designed to reflect those daily realities that investigators that work on site face. This preliminary site investigations, as Robert was saying, how do we identify, how do we generate trust in our first initial approach? That methodology develops those methodological steps. We've done so in the context in Honduras. Nonetheless, this experience has a broader applicability and can well be adapted to a number of other contexts. We developed 14 peace analyses, such as environmental crimes, the violence against environmental governance, solid waste management and recycling, carbon bonds, coastal pollution, indigenous communities, and building bridges. These were 14 areas of analysis of peace and conflictivity that provided those points of entry, clear points of entries that helped a better integration. And the design around conflict sensitivity in these programs were the relevance of mitigating potential damages that could come about from those interventions were analyzed. Potential damage and potential risk in such sensitive contexts where cooperation development is. Peace and conflictivity with the entry points was one of the strategies that brought about quick gains. It contributed in increasing the demand of our technical assistance on those programs. Those entry points were key for us, and they used the purpose of the approach. The process of how we develop these processes is enshrined on a quick guide on how to carry out peace and conflict analysis. This provides a general view, a practical and deep view on the specific components of peace and conflictivity analysis. It includes how to develop analysis, the investigation process, and whatnot. It will improve on the design and implementation of programs. This guideline is available online, and I am sure that my colleague can share the link on the chat. So I would like to repeat how adaptable this practice can be in other contexts.
Thank you, Ophelia. Abdurrahman, I'd love to turn to you to hear a little bit about if there's sort of one standard practice. I know we only have about 3 minutes left, so if we have just sort of a minute from you and a minute from Robert, we will then close. I will start adding in some links. I've put in at least the Safer World Hub, sorry, in South Sudan. I will put in the Honduras one, and I'll work on the DRC one as well. Over to you, Abdurrahman.
Thank you very much. Regarding good practices in the context of DRC, where the context is always changing at every moment, the good practice we put in place is the following of the relative information relative to the context. So we need to all the time update this information. I mean, we have to update the information regarding the actors, regarding the project to have the positive impact. Then another good practice is to adapt our training model in regards to the needs of our actors, of our partners. So we need to speak their language. That is why we have developed the tools to respond to their particular needs. For example, the conflict sensibility in certain sectors. We've worked with UN agencies. We've developed modules and orientation guides to take that into consideration their particular needs. We've talked to the conflict sensibility in the sector of transversal sector, because we are working in a particular context in DRC. Every month we have another humanitarian crisis and humanitarian shock. So we have to respond to these different clusters, and we have developed different models of conflict sensibility to have this possibility to offer post-shock protection. And we also, it's also important for us to have the feedback from the community which have received the humanitarian aid. And regarding the concrete examples, we are now developing the tool how to integrate the conflict sensibility in the education sector. And that has been the demand of one of the ONGs in the educational field, because we have about 10 different sites which are working in this area. But the situation, again, is evolving every day. So we need to understand how to include this conflict sensibility integration into this educational area. That is a question. Regarding, again, good practices questions, we have to work with coordination platforms. As I've said, in DRC, we are working with HDP partners, and we work with coordination platforms, with humanitarian partners, in priority, urgent priority zones. And we are implementing a coordination to help them orient and coordinate and harmonize their intervention on global level to have this positive impact with our aid. So I will stop here.
Thank you. Robert, I'll give you 1 minute, because I know we started a couple minutes late because these sessions are back to back, and then I'll close us out.
Thanks, Lisa. I thought under Rahman we were going to get through a whole session without mentioning HDP, but I'm really glad you did, because it is, conflict sensitivity is a thread that can connect the humanitarian development and peace. I just wanted to get that in there and reinforce that point. Maybe three quick things I'll get in the remaining 40 seconds. One, rather than budget a conflict sensitivity analysis as one-off at the start of a project, budget for an advisor that can support, coach, accompany you over time. That will help you to build the trust and understanding, have the flexibility to bring them in when you have a challenge and help you work it through, because that can't be predicted in advance. So that's number one. Number two, budget some flexibility. Crisis modifiers, sub-granting mechanisms, however you do it, however you get your donor to agree to do it, which is usually the challenge. You need to have clear criteria between your team members, between your consortium members, about when you can tap into that money to adapt the program in ways that can make it more conflict sensitive. And then the third thing is to build in space to your work plan to stop, pause, reflect, and adapt. Because I mean, especially, I think maybe I'm scarred from working too much on South Sudan and Sudan. It's so operationally focused and so response oriented that the space to do that is very limited. And even better if you can bring in external perspectives into those sessions as well, to be a critical friend that can help your team think things through. I'll leave it there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I wish we had another hour or two so that we could really continue to ask all of these questions and really dive into these models more. But I first and foremost, I cannot thank you enough. Just the expertise, the examples in terms of conflict sensitivity, integration, and again, the geographic diversity in terms of the context that we're facing. I think sort of a few things just to wrap this up in terms of key takeaways. I mean, conflict sensitivity, integration, I think is, you know, this is the call to action. This is the way that we need to be doing business. It doesn't matter if you're in a country like DRC or Honduras or South Sudan or Sudan, where the situations and the contexts are very different, but all of our programs, particularly in the peace building field and world, need to make sure that we are just how we do business is understanding the context, the interaction, and acting on it. I think a few other things that I've heard about is, you know, making sure that if we are requiring it, that we are providing training and resources. And I've linked a number of these resources there, as Orphelia mentioned just a moment ago. The peace and conflict analysis that has been utilized in Honduras, I think it was 14 times you mentioned, it's readily available. It's a how-to, and it's in Spanish as well, like making sure we have it in languages where people can actually pick it up and use it. You know, hearing about mentorship program and accompanying. And finally, just sort of underpinning all of this is piloting and adapting and making sure we're putting the resources to it. In my dream world, every activity would have key personnel of being a conflict sensitivity integration advisor on hand. It may not be Lisa Chandonnet Bedoya's world, but hopefully the more that we're able to share across, you know, regions and programs and activities and share resources and put them in solicitation and training, the more that we're able to do this sort of collectively and just making sure that we're hearing those voices, because that trust is sort of at the center of it all. So I digress. I apologize. We are a few minutes over. But again, thank you so very much to the Alliance for Peacebuilding for giving us this opportunity. Thank you for my esteemed colleagues for being able to be here and be such great resources. And again, the links are here. I also did want to flag that International Alert has this study of six different hubs. So that's also something that you can look at to sort of understand what some of the similarities and differences are. The resources are there. Please do, you can reach out, I believe, in almost every one of those. And thank you all, really, thank you so very much for taking the time to devote it to more on conflict sensitivity integration.